Ori, round 2. In the first video, we went through Nibble and Niwen. Now things are getting serious. It's time to have a closer look at the hero, Ori, and their relationships with the NPCs. What does the game teach us about the little spirit? A lot of good things. Here we go. Ori is a forest spirit. Despite this spiritual origin, they're a child of the spirit tree. Many things about them are decidedly human. Both games of the Ori franchise emphasize very human feelings. Motherhood for the first, through Naru's adopting Ori and Kuro's loss of her children, and brotherhood for the second, with a strong relationship between Ori and Kuro. We could find an ecological message in these games, but honestly, if we look at the choice of covers for each of the games, the emphasis is put on the relationships between the protagonists and how Ori will be shown. For the first game, we see Naru smiling, holding Ori asleep in her arms, rocking them. Ori is seen as a child, and the game will treat them as such. We will come back to this. For the second game, Ori is standing back to back with Ku, their adoptive sister. It is Ori as the little owl's sibling that will be explored. There is also on each of these covers a tree. The spirit tree for the first and the spirit willow for the second. They are key elements since they represent the hero's origin, then the sacrifice. The spiritual nature of Ori is challenged by their human upbringing and relationships, and the two games will lead to a kind of choice between these two natures in order to save Niwen as well as the relatives and friends of the little spirit. When I mention humanity, of course, some aspects of the characters are not purely human, but Ori features animals and spirits who are very humanized by their bipedalism and the emotions we can see them feeling. It's very classic and logical to see anthropomorphic animals when they are the main characters of a game. Although Seasons After Fall's player character is a non-humanized fox, unlike the little hero of Tunic, also a fox, who does roles as if he were in a Souls game and fights with a sword while having reached the ultimate level of cuteness. But it takes a particular dimension in Ori given how expressive the characters are. Despite the few dialogues, especially in Ori and the Blind Forest where only Sein actually speaks, and how their feelings are humanized with great accuracy. We see them laughing, suffering, too much suffering. The prologue of the second game is moreover very striking. Following the end of the first game, Ori is waiting as the birth of their adoptive sister is imminent. Ori's story is above all the evolution of a little being from birth to adulthood. At the beginning of the game, it is indeed the birth of Ori that we witness. We first see them as a leaf of the spirit tree, a spirit leaf if you will. Then when Naru finds them, the leaf transforms and they're already a cute little creature who deserves without any doubt the title of living plush toy. Then they're shown as a child who accompanies their mother in the harvest, helps her build a bridge, shows courage when the forest, blinded, deprives them of food. A forest spirit eats fruits, good to know if you want to befriend one. After that, the drama begins. Everyone dies. Yes, Naru, then Ori. But without them, no game, especially without Ori, so they will come back to life. How convenient. Even the DLC, added in the Definitive Edition, explores Ori's family even more, and especially childhood, evoking Naru's youth with her father and her sadly brief connection with two forest spirits. To reinforce what I was saying about the strong humanization of the characters, we see Naru's father giving her a very sonorous kiss, and more prosaically, both of them cooking with a cauldron. Do you know many animals that have a cauldron? I don't. The figure of the child dominates in the first game until the very last image, the egg that Kuro saved, cracking a new birth. Ori thus gets a different position in their family. The whole forest of Nibble could be the symbol of childhood, in particular the Jinzu tree, I'll come back to it. Many other characters also have family roles, which reinforces Ori's position as a child in Ori and the Blind Forest. We don't know how much time elapses between Ori's birth and the light ceremony that will lead to Nibble's decline, but the prologue suggests that it is not immediately after, precisely by the way the bond between the two characters seems to be established. There is a drawing of Ori and Naru next to the nest where the little hero sleeps. They build a bridge together, Naru's teaching, Ori's learning, and it's something that seems well established. They seem to share everything. Moreover, Ori is going to stay with Naru after the forest has been saved, not with the other spirits. Not much is needed to make the bond between mother and child meaningful. To Naru's smile when she holds Ori against her at the very beginning, answers the one she addresses to them to reassure them, whereas she is sacrificing herself for them. She suffers, but as soon as they look at her, worried for her, Naru smiles while refusing the last fruit. Before that, the way she looks at them, smiling, while they are both hiding away in Swallow's nest, mixes worry and strength so as not to let anything show in front of a child. When Gumo brings her back to life, thanks to the Gumon's knowledge, a mix of magic and technology, her first and only decision is to leave for Mount Horu, looking for Ori, decision that she will take again in Ori and the Will of the Wisps to find her two endangered children. She will do anything for them. In the same way, at the beginning of Ori and the Will of the Wisps, Gumo appears as a very fatherly figure. We can guess in the first game that the character will be important. We see him in the foreground at the end of the initial cutscene, while Ori fights in the forest, and then in the spirit caves, still in the foreground. He uses the knowledge of his fellow Gumons to bring Naru back to life, accompanies her when she leaves in search of Ori, and settles naturally in Swallow's nest. We see him calling Ori at Ku's birth, but above all, the two little creatures call on him to repair Ku's wing. The Gumons were engineers, not that it is really necessary to tie a feather with a bit of string, but it is a way of recalling his past. I think Naru could have done the task with great ease. She builds anything he wants, but Gumo needed to be highlighted as well. His role as a father is also reflected in a detail that always makes me smile. When Ku finally takes flight, in the foreground we see him make the gesture of flapping his wings to encourage her as any parent would. I think Ku knows about that, Gumo. It was the plumage that was the issue. Both mother figures and child figures are highlighted in the Ori games, since we have, of course, as the main antagonist of Ori and the Blind Forest, Kuro, whose rage was triggered by the loss of three of her children during the light ceremony. There is also Mora in Ori and the Will of the Wisps, immediately joined after the fight which opposes her to Ori by one of her babies, which comes to raise one of her legs as if to help her and then snuggle with her. Aww. A moment which earns its place in the top three adorbs moments of the franchise. Finally, the owls meeting Shriek are interrupted by their parents. Their reaction is portrayed without word, dramatically and seemingly animal-like, but it is rather human. It is so intense that one of the owls, putting their head forward when threatening shriek, hides the little children as if to show that this decision is not theirs. They are hidden again, voluntarily this time, at the end of the scene. Speaking of which, concerning the respective antagonists of the two Ori games, they are treated, seemingly, a bit differently. At first sight, Kuro does not appear as humanized, while Shriek is presented another way, especially thanks to the scene she shares with the three little owls, including Kuro perhaps as a nod. And especially after Ori has defeated her, returns to her parents, petrified by the decline of the Silent Woods. But what characterizes them is an extreme reaction facing a tragic event for Kuro, or a rejection due to an infirmity for Shriek, reaction which turns to genocide. But finally, wouldn't this cruelty pushed to the extreme be a way to humanize them? After Kuro sacrificed herself to save her last child, Naru and Gumo take care of this egg. Ori will thus become sibling. All the prologue of the second game is centered on this relationship, since it begins with Ori, eyes in the horizon, waiting for the birth of their sister, their reverie interrupted by Gumo. That's it, Ku is born. They carry her in their arms and, over the months, the years, help her when she learns to walk, tries to fly. Above all, they will be a support when it becomes too difficult for her to be far from her fellow creatures as she's still unable to fly. They find Kuro's feather so that she can finally fly away, and Ori accompanies her in her journey. The flight is real, but also metaphorical. I had to talk about metaphors. It is time for them to grow up, to leave Swallow's Nest without Naru nor Gumo for Niwen. After being separated from Ku, Ori's interactions with the NPCs show that their place within their family has changed. With the Mokis, they are like with their sister, a rather brotherly figure, the one who will complete quests, look for a small talisman, retrieve a lost object, warn a family in danger. Ah, the Mokis family in the Silent Woods. Another fun story. No Moki ended up as a statue, I promise. It's similar with Grom or Tule from the Wellspring Glades. We act as an apprentice. Well, we don't do much. We watch them randomly eat things with a hammer and plant a few seeds, but you get the idea. And unlike in Ori and the Blind Forest, where we were just helped by a spirit light, here Qualloc is different from a fatherly figure, is rather a kind of master, a guide, which could have seemed strange in the first game. These aren't particularly innovative interactions or quests, but they do make a lot of sense because of Ori's careful characterization. Although their personality is typical of a tale hero, as I had mentioned in the previous video, Ori is an extremely defined hero. They'll most never speak, only listen to Sein during the whole first game, but the rich cutscenes, as well as the animation and sound design, give Ori a certain character, readable emotions, where Hollow Knight's vessel supposedly felt no emotion and remained mysterious, though for me very endearing. Even if Silksong comes out one day and is even better than Hollow Knight, I will always remain faithful to the first game. The little vessel is my favorite character. We see Ori for a long time helping Naru to build a bridge to collect fruits. They go from joy to anxiety when they see their weakened mother, then find the courage to go and get some fruits to save her. In the second game, Ori wakes up Gumo by tinkling his face with a feather, showing their bond with Ku. In a shot of the trailer, shot that does not appear in the final game, the character however remained, we see them showing great curiosity as they meet Twinen, the shards guy. Curiosity that we find in the game when they touch the racing pedestals or when they're at the bottom of a wall and turn their gaze upwards as if to examine it. Then they meet Grom, and there again we can reasonably speak of extra cuteness when we see their surprised look, wondering where this voice comes from. Then they see the Gorlick, squinting, shielding their eyes with their hand. These are very nice details in the animation that reinforce their humanity by the way they react to others. Their relationship with Ku is very touching. Ku, who also shows all her humanity, the loss of her mother, her loneliness, her desire to join the other birds and fly with them. She air flies while looking at them. Ori is compassionate and does everything to help her. The scene when they find Kuro's feather in their secret box is also a beautiful illustration of the character. I really like how the sound design gives a more tender character to the scene. The object's sound isn't realistic when Ori throws them behind them. The fact that Ku is flying thanks to Kuro's feather is a very strong symbol. She carries something that belonged to her mother, and it allows her to emancipate herself. I recently read that Ku was supposed to die after Shriek's attack. Quite sincerely, I don't see what Ori could have done after that, except to let themselves die. Their bond with Ku is so strong from the beginning, it's even stronger than with Naru, as soon as Ori carries baby Ku, the little owl snuggles up to them, that I can't imagine how it would have been possible to make the story progress from Ku's death. The Mokis also show a beautiful range of feelings. Curiosity? Who's this little spirit sleeping in the rain? Who is this spirit that confronts Howl? It's funny, we see them during the fight, they appear in the background and flee once Howl has been scared away to find little Ori and give them the spirit blade. There's affection, even friendship, sadness when Ku is wounded. The scene is very beautiful when they meditate in front of the owl, their faces turned towards the ground, almost as if in prayer. They also grow during the game. At the beginning, rather curious, but shy, they do not leave Ku when she is suffering and Ori can trust them. They don't even look Ori in the eye. But Ori evolves. From only child, they become sibling, and you can feel it in the gameplay and the way they attack. In the first game, Ori is alone in the forest. Naru's dead, the little spirit, the little child, is completely left to themselves until the discovery of Sein, who attacks in their place. Indeed, the first game of the Ori franchise has this particularity that it is through Sein that the hero attacks. They have no weapon, rather a light orb that launches one or more spirit flames. According to the developers, this was a way to combine the need for an attack with the particularity that Ori is a fleeing hero. That's why the second distinctive element in the Ori games is the emphasis on platforming rather than combat, especially in the first game. Bosses in Ori and the Blind Forest are therefore actually escape sequences. Ori escapes a deluge inside the Chinzo tree, a storm within the forlorn ruins, and finally the antagonist Kuro in a burning forest. In Ori, this ranged attack works very well. I found it strange at first, got used to it, and then in Ori and the Will of the Wisps, it's the spirit blade that I found strange. Contradictions, you know. Recently, Ender Lily's Quietus of the Night also used a gameplay in which the player character doesn't attack but is protected by spirits that appear and attack in her place. This seems a bit less organic because the player character protects herself when her spirit attacks, as if she didn't want to look, and the standard attack mostly comes in series of three, which interrupts the movement a bit, but it's a coherent choice with the character. In Ori, though the hero doesn't attack themselves, this hinders the speed of the gameplay even less, as Sein attacks very quickly. Nevertheless, the first enemies we meet underline this escape, since they are the famous giant toads? No idea what they are. In any case, they have a very aggressive pattern, they jump very forward, and the safest way is to run away from them by attacking. Good old attack run technique. After the Chinzo tree, this approach is a bit different, because in that dungeon, Ori acquires a skill that allows them to attack, the famous bash, quite unique. You can redirect the enemy's projectiles or the enemies themselves and thus kill them. With this skill, the gameplay changes, since instead of avoiding the enemies by letting Sein attack, you can move towards the enemies by making your way through them, like this. You can just bash your way through the forest. Lovely. Ori grows as their approach to enemies changes drastically. This is always the skill I'm looking forward to the most, as I know it will open up a lot of movement and attack possibilities. This is why, for me, the Chinzo tree is, in addition to being an extremely pleasant dungeon, a very strong symbol of evolution in this forest of childhood, a step. This escape is not necessarily synonymous with weakness. Ori escapes the dangers of the forest, otherwise they would die, choose your favorite, drowned in the Jinzu tree, frozen in the fallen ruins, or burned within Mount Horu. This reaction reinforces their human aspect. They are precisely aware of this danger and does not face it blindly. In Hollow Knight, the humanity of the player character is very complex to apprehend. For example, is their attack a reflex? And this kind of puzzle would seem a bit strange. The only time we have to escape from something is when the cast of shell collapses after we have recovered the King's brand, and there we necessarily fade. It is indeed scripted to see Hornet's reaction, who saves us from danger and leaves without a word, as usual. In the second game, we immediately see the evolution of Ori thanks to the presence of Ku. They take care of their adoptive sister, comfort her, and encourage her when they find her mother's feather to finally live with her. The goal of the second game is to restore the balance of Niwen, to save it from the decline in order to save Ku, attacked and left for dead by Shriek. Still a very sad moment. Ori is thus in a more active posture. At first, they look for Ku, then face the forest mysteries and dangers to save her. They want to progress, to move forward, they don't intend to escape. This is why the second game puts much more emphasis on combat. There are more enemies, and especially real bosses, but always some escapes. Some incomplete replacement of a boss, the Wellspring, Boar's Peak, the Sandworm escape. Sometimes in short section before a boss, like for Howl and Quarlock, or between two phases of a fight, like for Mora and Shriek. And to highlight that Ori is now taking the initiative in this new adventure, from now on it is them who attack. First with a flaming torch, then with the spiritual weapons. We can even speak of a complete arsenal, since they have a sword, a bow, light burst ability, the flash, an aura of light damaging enemies, and in addition to that they can acquire the blaze, a fire skill, the spirit star, a boomerang attack, the spike, light spear, a sentry, a bit like Sein but with a much greater range, and when it is not attacking it has the shape of a butterfly. An attacking butterfly, Moon Studios. You like turning cute things into monsters, right? And most importantly, the hammer. in capital letters, of course, no kidding, the hammer. And some spirit shards on top of that. That's a bit much. In general, as I mentioned, Moon Studios seems to have a certain inclination to turn lovable characters into killing machines, the developers themselves finding that Kuro tried genocide after all. Those poor spirits. The spirit tree is responsible for the death of Kuro's three children, Ori becomes in the second game a killing machine, try the bow with the right shards and enjoy. I have already detailed in the first video the ambivalence of combat, most cathartic when you're attacking basic enemies, but more poignant when it comes to bosses. The mechanics also diversify in the second game, and there sometimes Ori takes the lead. They choose to face enemies in the combat shrines, or compare themselves to other spirits in the races, the spirit trials. This idea that Ori can choose, this idea of additional challenges, which weren't in Ori in the Blind Forest, illustrates how the position has changed in relation to the world around them. One could almost say that all this is a training for the little spirits, even if it's more for the player, before facing dungeons and bosses. They also have to carefully choose their weapons and spirit shards. It is no longer a passive ability tree, and also from now on, Ori can heal more actively than in the first game and with a very badass pose. Ori being really small, that badass pose isn't super clear. I swear it is badass. It's also a story that they don't experience alone. They are NPCs in Ori and the Will of the Wisps, and these are synonymous with help. Modest, if we think about the monkeys, but they are cute. And the merchants, because when there's combat, there's also fancy weapons and better shards to buy. If we choose the right ones, Ori becomes almost invincible, to be honest. In Ori and the Blind Forest, they were almost alone, accompanied by Sein, who talked to them from time to time, but the two other characters, except the antagonist, were not here at their side. We knew very little of Naru and Gumo's story, since Naru was resurrected by Gumo only after the second dungeon, thus in the last third of the game. This is still the case in the second game. Gumo and Naru are with Ori and Ku at the beginning and at the end of the game. In between, we see them only briefly. We're not that close to them. It is still a metaphor of individual construction. Ori and Ku's adventure is lived without their parents. They face dangers alone. Ori's story is told in a very explicit way. A narrator with a very deep voice can regularly be heard. It's the spirit tree in Ori and the Blind Forest, and they turn out to be Ori in Ori and the Will of the Wisps, according to the end of the game. This intended distance is part of the storytelling elements. The characterization of the characters through a rather emphatic animation, we'll see that in a few minutes, don't leave right away, puts even more accent on the story they leave. At the same time, Ori, in both games, but especially in the first one, is a witness. They discover the history of the forest, they react to what they learn, reactions that Sein verbalizes. If Ori looks sad, Sein says something to express Ori's sadness. We see this, for example, when they look at Kuro's egg, or when visiting the wind-torn ruins. When they enter the silent woods, they look at the petrified owls, Shriek's parents. They are therefore an actor, but also a spectator, a witness to the pain of the antagonists whose backstory they always learn, a witness to the suffering they, the antagonists, have caused. If some things cannot be undone, Ori can however bring help or show some kindness, friendship, in various degrees with the Mokis, with a lot of tenderness in front of the distress of their sister Ku, even towards the antagonists when they prevent Ser from attacking Shriek, then in a position of weakness and clearly frightened. She closes her eyes and turns her head when Sir charges their attack, then stares at Ori during a short moment, as if astonished by the gesture. Ori is undoubtedly an altruistic character, quality that they are going to take as far as sacrifice. Finally, after being shown as a child, then as a brother, they become an adult through their sacrifice, which they won't actually leave, not in a human form anyway, by becoming Niwen's new spirit tree and, incidentally, as we discover at the very end, the narrator of the whole story. Each forest thus seems to represent a transition, an adventure to be lived in order to pass from one state to another, from one age to another. It is almost allegorical. The image of the passing of time concludes this Ori cycle. The first game ends on vibrant colors, green and blue when the forest regains its height. The second one ends on a sunset, at night, while Naru rests against the new tree to which Ori gave birth. It's the end of a lifetime for some characters, the end of an adventure for the player. The Ori games are, in my case, very immersive by their sound and visual beauty, their nervous and inventive gameplay, as well as the empathy easily created with the characters. It's also the end of a cycle for the developers. It seems to me that the Ori franchise won't be explored after this game, at least not for now. The loop closes on several levels, since at the very end we find the graphic palette of the beginning of the game, when Ori is under the storm, but it is also similar to the beginning of the prologue of the first game, when the leaf that's coming off Ori tree recalls Ori spirit that came off the spirit tree during the storm at the very beginning of the story. Ori and the Blind Forest is almost a silent game except for Sein's dialogue, who appears as a rather loquacious spirit. Neither Naru nor Gumo are seen talking, nor Kuro. Ori and the Will of the Wisps being richer in NPCs, one could think it is more talkative. This is partly true. We are in a rather classic system where we only hear a few syllables for each NPC intervention, even in the case of those who reveal a good part of the lore, Quarlock and Bor, among others. But surprisingly, for the characters closest to Ori, their family, there is no dialogue. Only Ori shouts Ku's name when they're looking for her. Apart from that, neither Ku nor Gumo nor even Naru speak. Well, okay, sometimes Gumo growls a little and says his name. For these characters, everything is done through animation and music, hence the need for a certain emphasis on their attitudes to make their emotions very readable even without dialogue. I'm always fascinated to see that you can make emotions, a relationship, extremely readable with very little. Look at the Dunk Defender. I so love the Tank Defender. Everything is perfectly understandable, and yet his eyes are simply drawn. But the shape, quite big, convex, as well as the posture, slightly forward, show his interest towards the little knight, but not too much so as not to be intimidating, perfectly show the respect, the affection the defender has for the hero. Ori's graphic style is more detailed than Hollow Knight's, more realistic too, but not completely. It sometimes has a painted feel to it, unlike Bread though, which looks like a painting that would have just come to life. Especially concerning the characters, anyway imaginary for the most part, I never met anything like Gumo in my life, but maybe I didn't go to the right places. The faces remain rather simple. Naru's, for instance. Moon Studios never hid their strong Princess Mononoke inspiration. To compensate for this, the postures and reactions of the characters are often emphatic. While the animation of Ori's platforming is very lively, everything that is specific to the cutscenes or the interactions with the merchants, for example, or the emotions will be slower, more emphatic. Thus, Naru only has a few pauses when she meets Ori. Dazzled, she then moves her head forward to see them better, approaches to take them and hugs them in a rather slow rhythm. Moreover, in this prologue there are many short ellipses. Before building the bridge, Naru shows Ori the trees on the other side of the lake, then we only see a few steps, which gives the impression that the day is very long, that this is their whole life. It makes the bond between the two characters even stronger. Another example, when Gumo enters the forlorn ruins and discovers the other Gumons dead, his reaction isn't spectacular. He slowly blinks while looking around, stunned, and then crouches while putting a hand on one of the Gumons. The scene is short, yet its rhythm is slow. Gumo's two attitudes are very emphatic, but his reaction is perfectly translated, and we are even more easily in empathy with him. Ori is often seen with a distraught Ku to show her some support. We see them hesitating, cautious with the desperate Owlet, who's slowly shaking her head while moving away to watch the other birds near the lake. But let's take a closer look at the animation of Ori's player characters. This is what we call a high-quality transition. For example, Ku has very expressive eyes, and it's quite funny. When she refuses fruits and prefers slugs, Howlets don't eat peaches, that's basic nutritional knowledge. She closes her eyes and shakes her head. We read her anxiety when she hears Shriek's heavy steps when she has just found Ori. The way the characters look at Shriek in this scene speaks for itself. Ori does not take their eyes off her and looks much less worried than their little sister, who's glancing at Ori and Shriek alternately. Again, it's a way to show Ori's protective role. It's Ori who tells Ku to hide behind a tree stump, as well as their strength. They know that they will have to face Shriek sooner or later. Their posture is more determined, they head forward, but we still see their breathing speeding up. Yet Ku manages to change her attitude and there's a mutual protection between the two characters. Shortly after this first impressive meeting, a game of hide and seek starts between Shriek and the two little heroes. But when Shriek attacks Ori directly, Ku changes her attitude as we see the look in her eyes. It was fear, now it's anger. Having no other choice, glaring at Shriek, she waves her wings and then shakes her head defiantly to then return to a more childish attitude when she staggers at the end of the platform. Her attention is no longer on Shriek at this time. It's both extremely cute and perfectly unwatchable. Shriek doesn't hesitate to attack the Owlet when she's at her most vulnerable. Another little detail, at the very end of the game, when Ori has merged with Ser to become the new spirit tree and the plant starts growing, we see Ku blinking frantically as if she couldn't believe it. That is also very cute. Q is cuteness. And Baba is you. Wait, what? Ku has a little more interactions because she is one of the player characters. In the Silent Woods, after finding her, we go on to a gameplay section where we fly with her, and there, again, the animation is remarkable because, and that's a very nice detail, Ku looks down when she flies to underline her lack of confidence. We saw in the prologue she struggled when learning to fly. In the case of Ori, the main player character, the animation obviously covers different aspects. The game animation, the movements, and the little spirit's emotions. The animation of Ori emphasizes their human character. We see them breathing when they talk to other NPCs or when they're static. We also see their little tail moving, it's very cute. They yawn, they stretch, it's the first action we see them do in the first game. They're a child, undeniably. Physically, they are very agile, they do wall jumps with their hooves, and their movements show a certain childish joie de vivre. They're running very fast, their arms backwards, their jumps, they have a little salto if you time several successive jumps correctly. When they jump on the spring plants, they do spins, and we often hear them shouting for joy when they jump or when they obtain a new power. We hear it at the very end. Their liveliness is underlined by the physics, which are quite slippery when you are on some narrow platforms. The little guy can hold still. I do tend to make said little guy move a bit too much. The movement being fast, there is no latency. You run and dash instantly. For example, in Rayman Legends, there's a short latency when you want to run or fly. It's short, but it's there. It feels different. The specialization of the sound emphasizes the hero's speed as we hear the sound effects, Ori's and the world's, pass from one ear to the other depending on our position on the screen and our distance from enemies and objects. More generally, the gameplay offers a lot of freedom and you can easily play with your abilities or your weapons to go where you are not necessarily supposed to go. No need for flowers to explore the glades. Even Ori's evolution is highlighted in the abilities they have. They're even more acrobatic in the second game, as if they have grown and gained power. Thus, they can swing on horizontal branches to propel themselves and have a Mario-like animation where they're doing a handstand on some branches. On one hand, before sprinting, they're in position, ready to run. The second game is generally faster, especially more vertical and faster. In addition to the famous bash that Ori finds again, much to my joy, the grapple ability, the launch, the equivalent of a bash without enemy nor projectile, Ori propels themselves in any direction. There are also multiple dashes, the usual one, the water dash and the burrowing ability. All of this allow to reach great heights even faster. Grapple is more efficient than charge jump in the first one, which did not go too high and required to be, well, charged. The vertical dimension is more used in Boar's Reach, for example, where the light burst ability allows you to reach greater heights, and in the last fight you can't even put your foot on the ground in the last phase since there is no ground. The locations themselves now provide us with new ways to move, such as the physics of the wheels in the mill. By turning the building's mechanisms back on, we can propel ourselves and reach high places. All of Ori's moves, already very pleasant and dynamic in Ori and the Blind Forest, are now even more connected as if to show their power, their mastery. The spring plants have been improved. There are no jumping levels. Before, you had to keep the jump button pressed while jumping on these flowers to jump higher. In the second game, this is no longer necessary. You are directly propelled. On top of that, the moves are even more organic. The dash, in particular, reworked. Shorter but better integrated because Ori makes a roll instead of being vigorously pulled forward, and its cooldown is extremely short. The sound design of the dash is also better integrated because it's more discreet. I tend to spam the dash as soon as I can, and in Ori and the Blind Forest, it's quite noisy. The dash of Ori and the Blind Forest was an addition from the Definitive Edition, so it wasn't necessary to finish the game, while in Ori and the Will of the Wisps, it's there almost from the beginning. Precisely, the sound design reinforces the animation and underlines the character and the reactions of Ori while they're almost silent. If we listen to the jump, the whoosh, on the spring plants, there are three elements. The propulsion stage, the contact with the trampoline, quite percussive, in any case, very brief. Then there's a lasso effect, which retranscribes the spin that Ori makes when they jump on these trampolines. Yes, they're already that good. And Ori's cry, as if surprised and amused by the experience. Logically, when they make a double jump, we only hear the sound of the jump itself. It would appear, and I can understand, that it's less fun than being propelled several meters high, or sometimes diagonally, by a cyan blue plant with sometimes butterflies all around. Another very well-rendered effect is the sound when you save your game on a spirit well. As with the animation, it's in two parts. Ori performs a spin on the well, and then makes a funny little movement with their front paws to show their zen attitude. In the sound design, we therefore have, after an element acting as a feedback, the sound of the spin, the same as for the spring plants, with the last element crescendo, calmer and more crystalline. The spiritual aspect of the wells powered with spirit light, which accompanies Ori's relaxed posture and synchronizes perfectly with their little paw movement. Paws or hands? Good question. Beyond the sound design, to finish giving Ori a personality and a unique dimension, they have of course their own theme. When the vessel's leitmotif in Hollow Knight is very poignant because it refers to a function, that of all the vessels in the kingdom, the games of the Ori franchise have a named hero, completely shaped psychologically. When we hear it in an escape sequence or a boss theme, it's Ori who expresses themselves, it's Ori we're talking about. Ori's humanity is also shown in their fragility. Ori may be a spirit, but they're far from being immortal. So many deaths for my first run. And if the sound design shows them as an active character, by the very detailed foley, it does not fail to emphasize the mortal character of the little hero, not always in a positive way. Their sound design often features small screams, as I mentioned above, but also very light breaths, gasps when they jump, like in the triple jump. They're not the only one, because many NPCs have a sound design based on breath. For instance, Mora. When they swim and go back to the surface, we hear them take their breath noisily. When they get hit, they scream, so that we understand that they took a hit. It's also a little guy who dies before the beginning of the game. In the first cutscene, in psycho mode, the hero is killed after a few minutes. We see them without any strength, working on their fists, literally throwing themselves to move forward, their hand stretched out, trembling. Sadness. Fortunately, they're resurrected by the spirit tree, without which there would be no game. But sometimes, there is no game. And even before we really start playing, we already have a lot of empathy for them. We have seen them be born, die, and be brought back to life before our eyes. But Ori is a die and retry, the first one especially, and Moon Studios only thought, if we're going to make a die and retry, we might as well insist on the fact that a hero dies. So we have a nice drowning animation in which Ori puts their hand to their throat, and then we see their lifeless body floating as a little bubble pops underwater. It is very unspectacular, very realistic, and therefore quite confusing. Apparently, Ori was supposed to have more violent death. That's enough, Moon Studio. Otherwise, they explode in a bloodless way. Nevertheless, each type of death has its sound design. The height is reached when Ori dies in the lava. The sound speaks, no pun intended, for itself. We hear them burning. When they're insta-killed by a laser, we hear them shouting, broken into a thousand pieces by the laser. In Ko's case, when she falls into the swamps of the Silent Woods, a little scream is just as disturbing. I didn't manage to find it among the 2,400 sound files. I do apologize. Here it is. Despite this clear suffering, the gameplay manages to maintain a small distance as there is no interruption when Ori gets hit. In Death's Door, our little player bird falls heavily to the ground and the music muffles a lot when you've just been hit, as in Hollow Knight where the little vessel has a different posture when they only have 1 HP left, leaning forward, panting. They did the same thing in Greek Memories of Azure. Ori is shown in danger throughout the game by the fact that they're on the run and so small in front of the blinded forest and its dangers. Many times they suffer dizzying falls, they're Kuro's prey. After the Jin's tree escape, and especially when Nibble's ablaze, while they're about to bring back Sein in the spirit tree, Kuro takes Ori in her claws, crushes them. We clearly see that she exerts pressure like she did with Sein at the beginning. She wants to kill them, before throwing them on the ground as Naru rushes to help them. In the second one, it is rather Ku who's in danger. Ori goes to look for her, there is an evolution. The sound design of the deaths is still disturbing, but Ori is nevertheless seen differently, they suffer less. There are moreover very few insta-kills, which is nice in a game that challenges you not to die. Not even once. In this regard, the presence of NPCs helps because it allows them to interact. They make themselves useful and especially create bonds with the little monkeys. Small detail. Ori has a ledge grab, which is integrated with fluidity to the movements of the little spirit. This kind of element can bring some humanity, life, to a character because it gives them reactivity to the environment in which they evolve, in addition to showing some dynamism, for example with Hornet, who will have a more dynamic gameplay in Silksong, since it requires strength and at the same time it can highlight the character's effort, thus a certain weakness. No such thing for Hollow Knight's little hero, and it was very well chosen. It emphasized the only moment when we saw them in a real situation of weakness, when after the ascent of the Abyss, they watched the Hollow Knight and the Pale King both standing at the platform overhanging their birthplace before falling down. One of the player characters in Greek Memories of Azure has a very particular ledge grab. She puts her hands and feet on the ledge she is climbing. Her effort is clearly visible. Ori also has an animation when they're on the edge of a platform, a classic, or hanging from a rope. Ori's attitude in their run is interesting too. They Naruto run, body and head very much forward, which is quite surprising, especially for Ori in the Blind Forest, because they don't seem to be trying to protect themselves, despite how hostile the world around them now is. They're not the only one running forward. The player Luchador from Guacamelee moves very intensely, also very forward, even too much. It's unrealistic, but it's a way to accentuate the athletic aspect. It looks graphic because the character is taller, at the same time the run is slower than Ori's because the Luchador is much more powerful. Well, if Ori brings their spirit hammer, I doubt that the Luchador will survive. Here, it's a less active run, not necessarily for the purpose of exploration, but a bit more passive, discovery, which does turn into exploration in the second game since Ori has a personal goal at that point. In the excellent Katana Zero, the player character also runs this way, arms behind him, but it looks quite different. And of course, there's Sonic. he has is Naruto run too, like everybody else, but what the determined posture of the blue hedgehog translates is crazy speed. For Ori, it's a completely different effect. It's slower and especially more organic. Their tail undulates, their ears too, their arms a little. I find that besides the discovery exploration aspect I mentioned earlier, in Ori and the Will of the Wisps, it amplifies the beautiful design of Niwen's forest, where the platforms are completely part of the landscape. Ori moves like the platforms do. Ori's fragility, and even that of other NPCs, notably Ku, is always seen in a positive way. They're not clumsy. On the contrary, they're extremely agile. They're just in danger because they're surrounded by monsters, often disproportionate. They do extraordinary things and put themselves in danger for the sake of others. For instance, after the Wellsprings chase sequence, Ori falls. As usual, you might say. And while regaining consciousness, the first thing the Mokis say to them is that they're brave. Very brave. And soggy, but that's a fact. Soggy light being? Wait a minute. Ku's weakness, her having trouble learning to fly in the prologue, is related to her disability, not to clumsiness, whereas Link... Link? What the hell are you doing here? Well, there is a Triforce in Ori and the Blind Forest. Well, whereas Link is often shown in a weak situation in a rather humorous way. The game over motif, for instance, or even Link's sound design during combat, especially in Skyward Sword. However, Ori is a spirit, therefore they have kept some very distinctive spirit features. When they yawn or wake up, we hear a strange sound as if the sound effect was played in reverse and it's bathing an aura like the light around them. There is also a little guy who shines a lot while the NPCs spend their time telling them, and that the game itself highlights by some light effects. They create light effects on pretty much everything. Ori is the light. They can't hide the trail of light that follows them all the time, as if they were ripping through the air like their fellow spirits, as well as the small particles of light that come off them like petals. They're also modeled very differently from the other NPCs. If you look at Offer and Ori side by side, Offer seems almost made of clay? Makes sense, he is more agile than Ori. While Ori seems to be made of pure light, well, they are actually classy. We hardly hear it, but when Naru meets Ori in the prologue of the first game, the sound of Ori feather when they fly during the storm is very surprising, but reminds us that Ori is no ordinary feather. And then, Ori is a metroidvania essentially focused on platforming and known for its very versatile and for some original movements, notably the bash, signature of the Ori games. Ori therefore has quite phenomenal moving abilities, and once again the animation will emphasize it. Ori's characters and objects are animated in squash mode. They are deformed in a non-realistic way to give more amplitude to their movements. Thus, during a jump, the legs will become very small when you land. It can give the impression of a very strong and fast fall, and a rebound just as dynamic. During the jump itself, the proportions of Ori's body will completely change. Their tail becomes longer, their body stretches. Even Ku is deformed when she falls into Naru's arms after her flayed flight attempt. Her body lengthens. Her face flattens. I find that it makes more sense for Ori. The fact that they can deform so much can show their extraordinary nature. In addition to that, there are the abilities you gain. During the double jump, Ori rolls into a ball protected by the tail. in Ori and the Will of the Wisps, it's even more detailed. You can see their eyes open. The dash consists of an elegant and swift roll in Ori and the Will of the Wisps, and there are the two other dashes, the burrow ability and the water dash, during which Ori seems to transform into a small torpedo. Even in combat, Ori can deform to be part of the weapon, like during the hammer's down attack. Ori almost disappears and becomes one with the weapon. And plants also deform. This duality of Ori, being both a forest spirit and a very humanized one, is illustrated in one of the last shots of the Ori and the Blind Forest epilogue, in which we see Ori watching forest spirits appearing in Nibble as the spirit leaves of the spirit tree land on the forest, but Ori remains apart, waiting for Ku's birth. Their family is an important part of their humanity because this family is very humanized, which also makes them a very complete character, very defined by the multiplicity of their attachments and therefore of their relationships, despite their independence and the fact that we often see them alone. Despite being a spirit, we always see them interacting and helping characters who do not have this spiritual nature in them. Nevertheless, they do not hesitate to accept this nature, with which they seem to be less close. We do not see them joining their fellow creatures at the end of Ori and the Blind Forest, but they look at them. When the time comes to save Niwon and thus its inhabitants from decline, they give up their humanity. They will not be able to age to save her. Finally, in addition to being a metaphor for Ori's fast-track childhood, Nibble could also be a metaphor for Ori's spirituality. They run away from Nibble at first, as they would run away from their spirituality. In a way, Naru prevents them from having access to it by hiding them during the ceremony. She prevents them from leaving it. She wants to keep them near her because it is her child, and also maybe because of the link created with the two spirits when she was little. And this spirituality is besides an ambivalent element. If it brought Ori back to life, the spirit tree's light killed Kuro's three children. It also frightens Naru. Ori must, however, accept the light of the ancestral trees, the powers of their fellow spirits. Ori must remain in Nibble to save it as well. The escape is thus not complete. After that, Ori accepts Niwen. They move differently there, they actually confront it for Ku's sake, as they completely embrace their spirituality to save what makes their humanity. After all, Sein is as blue as Ori's halo, but Ser is almost as orange as Ku's eyes, as if Ori's spiritual nature was only important to them in order to save their family. First, Nibble shows them who they are, then Niwen shows them for whom they live. Thank you for watching this video. I'm glad you made it to the end. If you enjoyed it, don't hesitate to like it, leave a comment, and share it. Come on, don't be shy. And you can even subscribe to this channel and hit the little bell. You know, the usual. That would be great. Okay, thanks again and goodbye.